presentation to... Okay, students, let's begin lecture. We have a couple items of business to go over with you. First of all, I want to remind you that there's an SI review Monday next week, 6 to 8, in Classroom Building 1, Room 121 with Maria. So that'll help you get ready for exam 3. Another thing is the SVA food pantry food drive. And do you want to say a few words?
Go ahead,
introduce yourself.
All right, good afternoon, everybody. Hope you guys are having a beautiful day. My name is Donovan. I'm United States Marine. This is my coworker, David. He's a native in the Army, and my boss, Lee. He did 25 years in the Army. All three of us work at the UCF Student Academic Resource Center, right across from Barnes & Noble, right next to the CFP Arena. I see some of you guys already brought some donations. I just want to thank you.
If you have stuff now, bring it up to the front. And you can just do that right now while he's speaking.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for your donations. We are still accepting them. We partnered with the Student Veterans of America and the Student Veterans here at UCF. We're starting a Veterans Food Pantry, quite similar to the Knights Pantry for you guys, but ours is not just targeting those Student Veterans here at UCF. It's also going to the homeless veterans across Central Florida. So. Like I said, we're located in the CFP Arena, right across from Barnes & Noble and Towers, next to Jimmy John's. So if you guys have any more donations, we'd be very much obliged to accept it. Thank you so much. Yes, of course. Our office hours Monday through Friday, 9 to 5.
Yeah, we're supposed to have something for today, but...
Oh, yeah, this is, no worries.
Yeah, okay. All right, thanks, fellas.
Thank you. Thank you for your
time. Do you want to hold that stuff away now? You want to haul it away?
Yeah, we can go ahead and get those. Are you going to have another one, or do you want to talk about that?
Well, that's for today. This is it for today.
Okay.
And we'll talk about another time. We'll talk some more.
Thanks, Doug.
Okay, you're welcome. So, anyways, for those of you that don't, okay, here's some more. Hey, Marines, there's another. All right, good. Okay, so anyways, thank you for doing that, everybody. All right, let's get down to business for lecture. In the first hour class, the 10:30 class, the morning class, we had a demonstration. Troy Birmingham, one of the first hour students, brought his guitar and stuff. I'll point you out, since he's not here to do it in this lecture hall, I'll just ask, is there anybody in this class that has a guitar that they could bring to class and would be willing to and brave enough to come up here to the front of the class and demonstrate it? Yeah, can you bring it on Thursday? Yeah, and can you send me a message inside Web Courses and we'll do a similar... And for the rest of you, there's another YouTube called Carolina's Guitar in Web Courses. And you can, not in Web Courses, in YouTube, you can look at that. But I have another demonstration that I want to show you, and let's do that right now. And so go ahead and make a note. Demonstration number 1 and 2 for today are Faraday's, the Faraday cage and the jumping rings. Now, up here, I have a metal stand, and around it is this metal mesh, just fencing material. And what I'm going to do is take this radio, So, we're we're getting. Okay, so we're getting.
And it's been updated so that it works better on mobile phones. I'm Nina Totenberg. The best drama and often
okay,
the
worst so
in Washington is a seat at the U.S. Supreme Court.
Okay, so what I'm going to do is put inside this cage. This is called a Faraday cage.
As Mark Twain once put it, I like a good story well told, and that's what we do here at NPR. So thanks for listening to this station.
You have my natural support. Help pay for the news, information, and entertainment you count on. Help support WMND during the silent drive. Call 1-800-785-1. WMND.org.
Average for this time of year, with our
fair
middle
80s
and
into the upper 60s. For tomorrow, warmer temperatures continue with daytime.
The antenna, this is FM, and the antenna is all the way down.
Moving in, overnight lows in the upper 60s.
Juice it up a little bit. I'm not even touching it. My hand is acting as an antenna. The Faraday cage, so make a note, Faraday cage, demonstration number one. The electromagnetic field, which we're going to be studying in a few minutes, again, the electromagnetic field can be shielded. And there's a fundamental reason for that. This Faraday cage shields. Now, I'm out of juice now. See, I got to juice it up here.
Attended an election campaign, and FBI Director James Comey is now seen as anything but the.
Da da da.
Really not.
So.
Comey made a huge, possibly indefensible blow.
We'll just. I don't know how to turn it off. Anyway, just put it back in there. So the Faraday cage is a way to shield this radio from getting electromagnetic signals in. And it's not even enclosed up on top. If you ever work for a security firm or even a high-tech firm, a Department of Defense or FBI or something like that, that have to have ultra-tight security, a lot of times what they'll do is they'll put you in a room, your workspace, that he's either got in the walls anyways, he's got a metal mesh like this, or I even had a buddy, growing up, and he got a job for a big satellite company. And he, in other words, looking at the Russians through a satellite, and he was at the ground station, and he said, man, it sucks, because I'm in this metal room. It was lined with copper. And so that way, the computer work that he was doing couldn't leave the room. It was shielded from any signal going out of the room. And this one is shielding the radio from any signal getting to it from the radio station. So a Faraday cage, among other things. Oh, you know what else they use it for? If you've ever seen, like, on the Discovery Channel or something like that, they'll have these big Van de Graaff generators where they have lightning bolts that they generate. And what I've seen them do is they get a guy inside a Faraday cage, completely right between the two Van de Graaff generators that are throwing lightning bolts everywhere, but he's completely safe inside them. Although I would not feel safe. But that's what he does, and he's completely safe inside the Faraday cage. Another demonstration I want to show you is this one, the jumping rings. So observation or demonstration number two is the jumping rings. What I've got here is a generator. I shouldn't say a generator. I have a current going through some copper coils. You might be able to see it. And the copper coils are wound around this piece of metal here. Now this metal is steel. It's a bunch of small steel rods right down in between the coil. And if you know anything about electromagnets, you know, that having coiled wire gives you an electromagnet, but if you coil the wire around like a nail or something like that, the electromagnet's even stronger. So this is a real strong electromagnet, right? And as soon as I go like this, that turns it on, okay? Now, the whole idea of electromagnetic generation that Michael Faraday discovered is a changing magnetic field will generate currents, and a changing current will generate electromagnetic waves. Okay, so we'll change this, we'll turn on this electromagnetic, this magnetic field up here, this big magnetic field. It will induce current in this aluminum ring. And the current in this aluminum ring will start to go around and around inside this metal aluminum ring. And that'll form another electromagnetic exactly opposite direction. And when that happens, you'll see, what do magnets do when you go opposite, when you go north to north or south to south? They repel each other. And so what we're going to see is this thing is going to be repelled from this big electromagnet. All right? You got to watch carefully. Whoop! You see that? Jumping rings. You know, the Navy is working on a kinetic energy weapon. They call it the railgun. It's basically the same thing as this. Except it's a lot stronger. Okay, so jumping rings. Okay, and right here I have a ring that it looks almost the same, but the people up front maybe can see that there's a little gap in it, where they took a saw and just sawed out just about a millimeter of aluminum. So it's not a full ring. Zip zap. Now, watch what happens when I put both of them together. I put the good one on the bottom, because we know it'll fly. The other one on the top that has a little gap in it, it won't fly, but it will be pushed by the other one. That was pretty good. That's a good ring. Do you hear that? It's a good note. A good oscillator. Sweet! Can you hear that? Okay. Anyways, that's jumping rings. Okay, electromagnetic induction. Can you put these radios in this plastic bag? And see if you can disconnect the cables. All right. Let's keep going. All right. Okay, so the Faraday cage and the jumping rings. Now, I want to talk about oscillating systems. And as a preview, let me just point out that what we're about to do is very abstract, okay? And it's going to pay off for us when we get closer to the top of the mountain, the top of the mountain being periodic table for the semester. Okay, we know that the potential energy for an oscillating system is always some kind of square, one-half kx squared or one-half something squared. The word we use for that is quadratic. Now, this picture here, if you map out, see if I get my cursor. Here we go. If you map out the potential energy function as a function of x, it gives you a parabola, one-half kx squared. This is the one for the homework exercise last night, or one of the problems on homework last night. So when we say quadratic, the term quadratic means the square of the coordinate. Okay, so for the homework last night, if you're oscillating back and forth on the x-axis, then x squared is the item that shows up in the potential energy formula. So SPE equals 1/2 kx squared. Now remember the vocabulary term, k is the spring constant. and it gives you the numerical measurement of the stiffness of the spring, if it is a spring. If you have some other kind of an oscillating system, you might not have a spring, you might have something else, but it always looks something like this. Now the interesting thing is the kinetic energy is also quadratic in the speed. In this example, you would say that it's quadratic in the x component of the velocity, Vx. And that's the time rate of change of the coordinates. So as we know, kinetic energy always 1/2 mv squared. Okay. And here's something new, and I want you to start. This is where we start getting into abstract concepts. We're going to push this into a little bit of abstract territory, but it's going to yield some benefits conceptually for us. And that is, this formula, 1/2 mv squared, you can actually rewrite that or recast it into terms that are quadratic in the momentum, p subscript x. Right now, it would look something like this. So if your motion is along the x-axis, then the kinetic energy, 1/2 mv subscript x, quantity squared, is actually the same as 1/2 times p subscript x, quantity squared, divided by m. Okay, because p subscript x is mv subscript x. Square that. And then divide by m, and it gets one of the m's out of the m squared. You have good old 1/2 mv squared again. So this works out nicely. And for that reason, when you put the kinetic energy and the potential energy together in a total mechanical energy, things start to look interesting. Now look at what we got here. We have total mechanical energy E, which is conserved, and that's equal to potential and kinetic. And look at what we've got. We have some numbers in front of the square of a coordinate, and then we have some numbers, 1/2 times 1/m, in front of the x momentum quantity squared. All right? And this happens to have a fundamental significance in physics, because what you have there is energy, and one is the energy of position and one is the energy of motion, kinetic energy, and they're doing the same thing. They're quadratic in the two changing quantities. Position is changing, momentum is changing as it moves, you know, as more momentum over here, less momentum over there, and it has a bigger x-coordinate over here and a smaller x-coordinate over there. So this particular formula encodes all of that, and this is called the conservation of energy for an oscillator. Now, a couple things about this. This diagram over here to the right, we used it last week, and we talked about a full cycle. We used it in the context of defining amplitude. In other words, amplitude was the length of this segment from equilibrium out to max extension or max compression, or vice versa, from max compression back to equilibrium. And that was the amplitude. Now, I'm reusing this diagram because there's something interesting about this if you think about it. You know, when we did that table of free fall, the energy levels in free fall for a basketball or a baseball or anything, you know, we always started with kinetic energy zero at the top. And all the energy was potential energy at the top for the free fall problems that we worked on. Okay? Same thing is true here. But it's not at the top of the motion. It's at maximum extension. At maximum extension out here, all the energy is potential energy. It's all 1/2 kx squared. Because out there at maximum extension, and similarly at maximum compression, so at these two positions, far left and far right, the object stops and turns around. It's called a turning point in the motion. And at that point, you're all potential energy. And you're zero kinetic. Right? So you can make a note of that. But don't forget, kinetic energy goes to maximum. Where does that happen? It happens at the equilibrium point. All right, so that's right here. At the equilibrium point, right here at x equals zero, the kinetic energy is maximum. All of the energy is kinetic, so capital E equals KE max at this point. All right, and at that point only, there's no force acting, or the force acting is equal to zero. All right. And so the oscillator, or the simple oscillating system like this, has all these symmetric properties. You know, maximum potential, zero kinetic at the turning points. Maximum kinetic, zero potential at the symmetry point. Equilibrium, x equals zero. Another interesting, well, let me pause for questions. I want to go nice and slow through this. For those of you that were thinking of or hoping to be invited to become an SSG leader, I sent those messages out in web courses this morning. And so if you haven't looked at your inbox in web courses, you've got a message from me and a PDF that you have to print out. And I've gotten some printouts from people. Try to print them out full size like this and then sign them. But anyways, print these out and bring them on Thursday. Unless you have it right now, you can bring it up after class. Caroline and Darian and the other TA will help you with tips and stuff like that. Okay, if there's no further questions, let's keep going. Another interesting thing about an oscillator system. Now, this one's idealized, no friction, and no extra pushes anywhere, you know, so you don't have somebody, you know, poking it or anything. There's no friction or anything like that. You know, so just a kind of an idealized oscillator. Another thing is the frequency is fixed no matter how far out you start it. So, you know, on the homework last night, We had X maximum set to 0.033 meters, okay? 3.3 centimeters. Now, if I pulled it out to 0.038 meters, a little bit further, I'd still have the same frequency. I'd have different energy. You know, total energy would be different, but the frequency would be the same. And it works out that the frequency F is a simple square root of the spring constant divided by the mass. That's it. In this formula for total mechanical energy, E equals 1 half kx squared plus 1 half px squared over m. The only two constants in there, well, capital E is a constant, but the position changes, the momentum changes, but then the constants of the system are K, the spring constant, and then M, the mass of the actual object that's attached to the spring. All right? And those are two constants. They're in the design of the system. So you can design a system with a spring and a mass, and if you set them just right, you can have any frequency that, you know, within reason, that you like. Okay? And so it's a particularly easy formula. Now, I'm not saying that you're going to have to calculate frequency using this formula, okay? But I am saying that the frequency is set once you have a certain spring strength, okay? And once you have a certain mass, m. And so no matter how you, and here's another note, no matter what your initial conditions, so write this down, no matter what the initial conditions, no matter how far out you start to the right or to the left, no matter what your initial velocity, if you start it with a kick to the left or to the right, no matter what, the potential, the frequency of the motion, the oscillation frequency, is set, no matter what the initial conditions. And that's kind of a cool feature of this system. There's a lot of interesting things about oscillators. This is just one of them. Now, this is technology. This is kind of dragging stuff out. Those of you that have had calculus, we're about to do some stuff that is going to encode a bunch of calculus. All right. Now, I want you to look at this yellow box that has the total mechanical energy. And on the right, we have something quantity squared, and then plus sign, and then another something, different something, Sarah, quantity squared. Right? Now, on the left, we have capital E. Now, that's not something squared, but it is E equals something squared plus something else squared. Okay? Now, can you think of a mathematical formula that has something equal to the sum of two different squares? Something squared plus something else squared. Does that ring a... Think. What do you think? Something squared plus something else squared. Raise your hand if you have an idea. What do you think? Yeah, Pythagorean theorem. A squared plus B squared, that's the sum of the two squares, equals the square of the hypotenuse. What's your name again? Taylor what? Taylor Carpenter, good, okay. Okay, so Pythagorean theorem, yeah. So let's think about a right triangle. Now, total mechanical energy E is not a square, okay? But the potential energy has a square in it, so we could, and kinetic energy. So, you know, we could think of, kind of analogically, using an analog or analogously, about a right triangle. And what I want you to think about is the following. In a simple oscillator system, the kinetic energy and the potential energy change, but they always add up to E. Now, if you have a set triangle and you say that the hypotenuse is the same, what it means is you can have a bunch of different triangles, but the two perpendicular sides can change, but the hypotenuse is always the same. So I want you to think of those two concepts kind of side by side, two halves of an analogy. Kinetic energy, potential energy, and total energy on one side, and then vertical side, horizontal side, and then hypotenuse of a right triangle. Now, we can do that. We can have, you know how you do it? You take a circle, and if you say that you want to draw any triangle, any right triangle, whose hypotenuse is a certain length, what you do is you make a circle of that length, of diameter equal to that length, and then you choose any point on the circle, and that'll form a right triangle, and the hypotenuse will be the diameter, okay, always. So you can do this. You can say, you can easily construct a right triangle that for which the hypotenuse is always the same, but the two perpendicular sides are different, you know, any point on a circle. What that means is, for us, if we think in terms of dynamics, this point at the corner, this vertex, represents a point on the circle that I just mentioned. And if we're thinking in physics terms, not geometry, but in terms of motion, it represents the combination of potential energy and kinetic energy for the system. So what I'm saying is, the potential energy and the kinetic energy of that mass on the spring as it shuttles back and forth from max extension to equilibrium and out to max compression and back, the potential energy and the kinetic energy are changing, it, but they always add up to the same kinetic energy. Same thing here. The vertical side and the horizontal side, they can all be different, but if you keep the hypotenuse the same, you've always got a right triangle. All right? Now, the way that you organize all the different points for which this is true, you know, so all the different vertices here, think of all the different right triangles, same hypotenuse, different height and width. The way to do that is to construct a different geometric diagram. And the diagram that encodes all those points, all those vertices, all those right angle vertices that represent the dynamical state is an ellipse. So draw two axes, one vertical, one horizontal, and let's call the horizontal axis X. And let's call the vertical axis, abstractly, P subscript X, the X component of the momentum. This is the oscillating component of momentum. So in the total mechanical energy, here's X, here's my component down here in the potential energy term, and here's P subscript X, the square of which helps to form the kinetic energy term. All right? Now, all these dynamical states that are possible, all the different right triangles that you could think of and still have the same hypotenuse, correspond to all the points on this ellipse. Okay, so this is a way of encoding in one picture all the possible dynamical states of an oscillating system. Let me repeat that. If you make a perfect ellipse centered at the origin, this ellipse encodes all the possible dynamical states of an oscillator system, an oscillating system. For instance, up here at the very top of the ellipse, that's maximum positive momentum. Hey, let me ask you guys a question. X-axis, we're oscillating back and forth, left and right. Okay, right, positive, left, negative. What does positive momentum mean? What direction are you going if your momentum is positive? You're going rightward, okay? So this, you could put maximum rightward momentum if you want, right? Here's another thing you can just, you know, for all the dynamical states, here's maximum leftward position. And, you know, in the diagram that we were looking at a few minutes ago, that would be max compression. So maximum leftward. You know, there's a lot of different ways you could express that point. Mental IQ test. What's the value of the kinetic energy right here at maximum leftward position? Goose egg, zero. That's right. And your total mechanical energy is all potential out here. It's a turning point in the motion. Here's the other turning point. Max rightward. Kinetic energy, goose egg again. And why is that? Because at this point, and at max leftward extension, or max leftward position, your momentum is zero for that instant of time. Okay, because you're not positive up here, you're not negative down here, you're zero for that instant of time. So no kinetic energy, all potential. Same total mechanical energy, capital E. Now, similarly, here's another landmark. Maximum negative momentum. Negative, it's below the x-axis. And that corresponds to what direction? Which way are you going? Leftward, that's right. Okay, so make a note. Leftward. This one diagram, if you know, you know, you actually could have mapped this out last night. Ooh, that inspires me. to write a homework problem. Ah, yes, I'm getting a brainstorm. I always get brainstorms in the middle of class. Morgan, this is why it's so important for students to be present when you're teaching. Because they, you guys inspire me. Anyways, this would make a cool... So if I give you the maximum energy and the maximum X, you could map out an ellipse. You have to think about this. You could map out the X exactly, the ellipse exactly. Anyways, bottom line, the phase diagram or phase portrait for the oscillator system is completely enclosed. It encloses a limited area on this graph paper. This is not X and Y graph paper, so the units of area are not square centimeters or square miles or acres or anything like that. The units of area are different. And for a different system, like a basketball in free fall, your phase portrait would look completely different. It wouldn't be a nice ellipse or a circle. A circle is a kind of an ellipse, a special version of an ellipse. So let me ask you this question. Go ahead and get your clickers out. Let's think about the area units for this ellipse. All right, so here's your four options. What are the area units? And this is a brain burner. This is abstract, so just think. How come you had to go back there to get your clicker?
I left it at her house. So she brought it.
Okay, very good. Clickers have a way of growing legs and ending up at other people's houses and stuff like that. It's very interesting. Look at this. Look at this data. Okay, 15 seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Ching. All right. Now, 31% of you voted for A, and A is tempting, because A is tempting because we get the ellipse from, we get the ellipse from the energy equation. You know, 1/2 kx² plus p squared over 2m. But it's not energy. Distance, yep. Option B is tempting but incorrect. Psych. 8% of you voted for that one, so I just psyched 8% of you. That's one of the axes, yeah, so but that's not the area. Area is the dimensions of one axis times the dimensions of the other axis. The other axis is momentum. So that's not the right answer. Angular momentum. Ching. Did you get that one? Ching. All right. Now, angular momentum, kilogram meter squared per second, is also known as, in this context, the action. All right. So this thing, this oscillator is not really spinning. It has a frequency, but it's not spinning or rotating or anything. But you, it has an action, and the units are kilogram meter squared per second, the same as angular momentum. So we would say, well, the action of the system is 4.5 kilogram meter squared per second, or 6.3 times 10 to the minus 34 joule seconds. That's also the unit of action. And so now, my wonderful students, the reason that we're talking about this, all this stuff, is to get to this ellipse. This ellipse is going to be our secret back way to get into the top, to get up to the top of the mountain. This is going to, and you don't see it now, but I know it. We're going to use this ellipse to understand the periodic table and what atoms and electrons do in the periodic table. It is most easily understood in terms of an ellipse and ellipses like this for electrons orbiting nuclei. So make a note of that. And one more vocabulary term. This is not a picture in XY two-dimensional graph paper space. Okay, so it's not physical, it's abstract. This is called phase space. It's a phase diagram or a phase portrait in phase space, right? For a simple, regular old oscillating system. Spring with a mass attached. Okay, phase space. So this ellipse in phase space is our short, it's not a shortcut, but it's the best route to the top of the mountain. Now, to get the rest of the way up the mountain, we got more ground to cover. Let's get back to electromagnetism, and we're just going to take some attitude. It's a big topic, but we're going to run it down, just like this little dog trying to track down this big old rhino, right? Now, that's one of my favorite pictures. Now, let's go back to the 1700s. Let's talk about Coulomb, Charles Coulomb. He was a military engineer down in Martinique. And then in the year of our independence, no, in 1776, yeah, that's our independence. He moved to Paris and became an academic scientist. So in other words, he sat around with the other eggheads up there in Paris, you know, eating cheese and stuff like that. And one of the things, but he was an engineer, so he was a little more useful than that. And one of the things that he did was he developed a device called a torsion balance that was used for measuring very, very small forces. So in other words, it's a balance that stays horizontal and twists. It's not a regular lever balance like this, you know, where you measure two masses. He used his torsion balance that moved horizontally, not vertically, like a seesaw. And he used it to measure very, very small forces between electrically charged, triboelectrically charged objects. So taking a glass rod. Now remember, these are the days of Ben Franklin, okay, 1776. And so they were still working with triboelectrical methods. You know, so they rub a glass rod with some wool or something like that, develop some charges, and maybe rub something else with silk and develop some more charges, and then kind of see if they attract and repel and all that stuff. Right now, Charles Coulomb was the guy that figured out how to measure all those things, and he figured out the force law, kind of like Newton did for gravitation. Okay, for Newton and gravitation, it was the law of universal gravitation, which we've studied. For electromagnetic forces, it's the Coulomb interaction. And so his device, the torsion balance, is what he used to figure out the forces between really teeny electrical charges. It's very hard to accumulate a good amount of electrical charge because it'll discharge and it'll go to ground very quickly. In other words, here in Florida, the reason you can't, you know, get a lot of static and stuff on a humid day is because the moisture in the air channels away all the electrical charge that you might build up. So you don't really get that much static here in Florida unless it's a really dry day. Anyway, so this torsion balance is what we're going to take a look at. Now, here's a perspective view of the torsion balance. All right, and it's kind of dim colors here. Look at the YouTube for a little bit more vivid colors. In this diagonal line segment connects two small red spheres in my diagram. One over here on the left in front of this big bowling ball, and one over here on the right, up and to the right at the other end of the diagonal line segment behind this other black bowling ball. All right? In the middle here is the torsion fiber. Okay? And so if there's some forces acting to twist that fiber, it's got to be balanced really well. You know, so it doesn't go up and down. But if it twists, you can calibrate it so that for every degree of twist, it corresponds to so many newtons of force. You know, so it wants to stay. It's kind of like a spring, a little bit like a spring system. In other words, it wants to stay at equilibrium. But if you twist it one way, it takes a little bit of effort to twist it. And then when you let go, it's going to come back to equilibrium. Okay. So what Coulomb did was he charged up these little teeny red spheres and the big bowling balls and got them to attract each other or to repel each other. And they twisted the fiber. And then he was able to correlate that to a number of newtons of force and then figure out the force law. Here's an overhead view. Okay. Now here's the from upper left to lower right, that's the torsion arm, okay, or the torsion arms. Right here in the middle where this X is, where my cursor is, that's the torsion fiber. You're looking straight down it, so I replaced it with an X. So the overhead view. And then over here is a big old 12-inch diameter bowling ball. And we're going to charge up the little red one and charge up the black bowling ball. And then see if they repel or see if they attract and measure it. And we're going to measure the amount of torsion or twist in this torsion balance. All right. So, for instance, if you have a certain amount of twist, and here's the 2-inch diameter sphere here. If you have a certain amount of twist, you have this angle. Now, this one looks like, 15, 20 degrees maybe. Okay. And that corresponds to a certain number of newtons, all right? Now, the other thing, and here's the twist. There's your rotation, just a little bit, in this instance anyways, all right? This, and don't forget, this is kind of an idealized or schematic view. Here's the distance r. So center of mass of the bowling ball to the center of mass of a red small red sphere, so that's like a red 2 inches. That's a little bit bigger than a bowling than a ping pong ball. Anyway, so think of this as a small, and then the twist angle right here. Here's the twist angle, and you can correlate that twist angle to a certain number of newtons. All right, so you have the distance, you have the newtons of force, and you know how much you've charged up each sphere. So you can get all this stuff and measure it for different amounts of charge and see what the pattern is. And the pattern is very similar to the law of universal gravitation. So in other words, it's a pairwise interaction, charge to charge. And my diagram up here shows two charges, Q1 and Q2. Oh, by the way, the symbol for charge that we customarily uses Q. So in gravitation, the quantity in the numerator of the law of universal gravitation is mass, M1 and M2, and that's measured in kilograms. In the electromagnetic or Coulomb interaction, we use the symbol Q. So two charges, Q1 and Q2, separated by some distance R, and he was able to measure the force on those charges or between the charges. And he figured out how big the charge was by, you know, how much he had to, you know, rub the glass rod with rabbit fur or whatever, you know, whatever method he used. Okay. And then he measured the distance apart and he knew that it was weaker with distance. And it turns out, see if I can move this thing. I can't even move this. I have no idea what that is. It turns out that here's the equation. I think I have an animated GIF in here that I forgot to delete properly. So it gave me that little thing there. Sorry, it's gone now. Here's the force law. And it looks just like Sir Isaac Newton's law of universal gravitation, except this is with charges in the numerator, Q1 and Q2. And there's a constant of proportionality, K. That's known as Coulomb's constant. In the metric system, it's 9 times 10 of the 9. And it converts charge and square of a distance into newtons. And we're not going to calculate with K, but we could if we had a notion to. And that is the formula that Charles Coulomb figured out. Now, a couple things about it. It's unlike gravitation. There's two kinds of electric charge. And for that reason, the Faraday cage can do its thing. There's two kinds of charge. You know, Matt, if you think about it, universal gravitation, everything attracts everything else. All right, so everything, that's just the way that universal gravitation works. But with electromagnetic interaction, there's two kinds of charges, so you could get repel or attract. And because that's the case, you can, a Faraday cage will work. You can screen it. You can nullify the force. That's another way to put it. You know, you can't nullify gravity. Nobody knows how to nullify gravity. But we can nullify electrical forces. Okay. Now, charge doesn't measure in kilograms, so it's not like gravitation that way. And two charges can repel if they're like charges. And the fact that it's an inverse R squared force, again, means that it has infinite range. So theoretically, all the electrons in your, all the electrons in your left earlobe are interacting with all the protons in the Washington Monument in D.C. and all the protons in the center of the sun. But the problem with that is all those protons can be screened. And they're surrounded by protons. There's protons and electrons everywhere. And so there's a lot of screening effects. So we don't really think about the electromagnetic interaction as having a global size, but theoretically it is infinite range. And the photon, which is the quantum particle of the electromagnetic field, is massless. And one way to express that is the fact that if the force law was R to the third power, that would represent a force in which the photon had a mass. It wouldn't be infinite range. It would be limited range. But if the force law is exactly R squared in the denominator, not R point, not 2.001 or 2.00 anything, or 1.99 something, but exactly 2, then you have something that we call infinite range. Now, once that force law was known and verified, this object became a useful measuring device. And why is that? Well, if you load up extra electrons onto the top, so this is like a glass beaker from the chemistry lab, and you pump out all the air, and then you put the stopper in, okay? And through the middle of the stopper is a metal rod. At the lower end of the metal rod are two very thin leaves of metal foil. Frequently gold is used. It's very, very light. It can be pounded very thin. And then at the other end is the probe. This sphere up here is the thing that you charge or the thing that you connect to put in contact with the object that's charged. Okay? And so if you have some negatives up here that you acquire, that'll drive a bunch of negatives down here to the opposite end. And it'll cluster near the extremities. right? And so you have some charge on the top, and then you have charge on the two leaves, all right? And if you do a little bit of trig and stuff, you can, and here's a side view of it, okay? You do a little bit of trig and a little calculus and stuff, you can figure out the net force on those leaves, you know, because so many Newton, if you know the size of the leaves and their mass, and, you know, do a little trig, you can figure, okay, so many Newtons sideways will get me so many degrees of separation between the two leaves. So you can measure all that stuff and figure out the size of the forces and therefore the size of the charges. And this is a way to measure the amount of charge that you have on the device. It's called an electroscope and it works really good. And I've used it in the lab. We still have, they're kind of old-timey now, but I believe there's still people that use them for certain very specialized applications. You know, we have other ways to measure charges now. All right, so that's the sideways view of an electroscope. Now, I'm going to ask you some more clicker questions here. And I want you to look at this array. There's three pairs of charges here. Now, E is the symbol that we customarily use. It's called the fundamental charge. It is the charge on the the charge on the electron is minus 1E, because electrons are negative. And plus 1E is the charge on a proton. So in this picture now, we have at the top pair is a pair of electrons. And the middle pair is a proton on the left and an electron on the right. And then the bottom pair is a pair of two protons, plus 1E and plus 1E. Right? And I always, just so you know, when you're working in web courses and stuff like that, I usually make electron or negatives blue in honor of my old chemistry teacher in high school, Dr. Cooper. He always said electrons are blue. And so red denotes positive, and the proton charge is E, the electron charge is minus E. And let me ask you a question here. Let's see if you guys can answer it. It's about this set of three charges. Which pair or pairs have repulsive interaction? Go ahead and answer me that.
Yeah, it's
a clicker question. Go ahead and answer. Seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Okay, good. Most of you guys answered correctly. So top and bottom repel. And so the ones in the middle attract. Now let me ask you this. This one's not a clicker question. But let me ask you this. Which pair has a stronger interaction force, either attractive or repelling? The top pair, the middle pair, or the bottom pair? In other words, which pair gets pushed apart or attracted with more Newtons? I have somebody up here saying they should be equal. But that's correct. Why should they be equal? Well, if you think about it, the distances are the same. You know, they're all kind of racked up the same distance apart. And the, pair by pair. And the numerator is an E and a minus E, or a minus E and a minus E, or a plus E and a plus E. So the size of the numerator doesn't change. The size of the denominator doesn't change. So the force is going to be the same. Now, question number two, if you dare. Now, this one's a little tougher. What direction is the net electric force? Now, neglect gravity, just think of electric. You know, because they're going to have some weight force, but let's leave that out for now. Net electric force. And let's see this. Net electric force. See, because the rightmost proton is going to get some repulsion from the middle proton, and it's going to get some attraction from the electron out there on the left. 10 seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. You know what? I got to give you guys credit. You're all. This is the genius class, the genius section, because and the reason I know that is because there were some nimrods in the first class that voted for C, and there were a bunch of wiseacres that voted for D, and there is no D. Anyway, the answer here is right word. And the reason for that is, if you think about it, the proton on the right gets some right. Better write this down. Better write my comments down, because it's going to be helpful for homework. Oh, yeah. Homework. The rightmost proton, it gets some repulsion, and it's going to, from the middle proton, and it's going to be pushed off to the right. All right, now, the electron is going to give some pull off towards itself. So that rightmost proton is going to be pulled to the left by the electron. But the electron is twice as far away. So the force is going to be a fourth of the nearest neighbor force, the proton-to-proton force. So the proton-to-proton force wins. More newtons rightward, fewer newtons leftward, the net is going to be rightward, which is the answer here. Now, I have some good news and I have some bad news. The good news is, at my house for trick-or-treat, we had some leftovers. So I have a whole bunch of... What? Where... Oh, here they are. I have... Caroline gave me a heart attack. She put them in the other bag. I have a whole bunch of leftover candy. You can come up and get this when I dismiss you. And actually, here, I don't know what this is. Some M's, and I believe there's some Reese's in there. Ooh, there's a Twix. And the other, the bad news is there's no homework tonight, but do study 8-1, 8-2, and 8-3. And you can be dismissed. Turn the lights on.
Got Reese's? Yes. Yeah. Wait, is there another one? Do you want to split it?
No, I want to get this. Thank you.
Welcome. Help yourself. The Reese's are always the first to go.
That's my favorite.
Yeah.